works?
Yes.
100% sure?
It's green, yeah.
Green, okay, good.
Well, it's a sound problem.
Good, yeah.
Okay, perfect. So, last time we discussed this combinatorial version of the Chicanov-Eliasberg DGA, which works in dimension 3. And now I'll talk about the proper, I mean, not proper, but more general definition of this algebra. So the way it's presented, or the way it follows from the work of Eliasberg, given Talley and Hofer, the way it appears in the symplectic field theory. And Lenny N was the person who actually proved the equivalence of these two versions. And then I'll get to things like linearizations of these algebras. I'll explain how Lagrangian cobordisms come to the story, when this algebra provides a homology which has a topological flavor, and this type of stuff. But in order to discuss a more general definition, I'll need to adapt one thing. So when we talk about grading, you'll actually need the notion of the Maslow index and Conley-Zander index. So let me talk a bit about that. So Maslow index and Conley-Zander index. Because in dimension 3, of course, everything was combinatorial. And I cannot leave it on such a shaky ground and say that in high dimensions we do it like similarly. I mean, I need to provide some proper way of doing this. So let me start with the following. So first we take lambda n. So it's a Grassmannian manifold. Or some people say Grassmann, some people say Grassmannian manifold of Lagrangian submanifolds. Actually, not submanifold, subspaces, subspaces in CN, subspaces in CN, so just linear subspaces. Some people also call it Lagrangian Grassmannian. So Lagrangian Grassmannian, that's another name. Grassmannian. Basically, it's a manifold, right? So maybe it looks a bit scary, but so Cn is the same thing as R2 to n, and we take a standard symplectic 2 form of the form dxi dyi, where here we have coordinates x sub 1, y sub 1, x sub n, y sub n. And this is a vector space. We have the symplectic form. We consider Lagrangian subspaces. Lagrangian subspaces are subspaces of dimension n that are everywhere, such that this form is everywhere zero on these subspaces. Right? So basically, Lagrangian subspaces are Lagrangian subspaces are subspaces of dimension n. Of dimension n, where this form vanishes, said that they are Lagrangian, said that the form, the symplectic form vanishes, so symplectic form and then vanishes on them vanishes. And what we can do, we can consider all such subspaces. And if you take so it turns out that if you consider all such subspaces, this type of thing has a structure of a manifold. And the way to get it is basically the following. So if you take W, Lagrangian subspace, we can take its orthonormal basis. So take its orthonormal basis. which will be also unitary basis. So which is unitary basis? Then we can say that un acts transitively transitively on lambda n and O n and O n preserves our W. So O n is a subgroup of U n, and this group preserves W. So with this we can say that lambda n can be identified is basically a quotient of U n by O n. Okay. And to be honest, this type of thing can be also identified with a group of linear symplectic transformations. Okay. So it's a manifold of dimension. So it's a so it has dimensions or dimension of this lambda n is what is it, n times n plus 1 over 2. Okay. Also one thing to notice is that, I mean, it requires some proof, I'll not write it down because it will take some time, but so if you take lambda n okay, so I wrote, let me write n like this. So if you take lambda n, then pi 1 of it is the same thing as h1 of it, and it's z. So pi 1 of lambda n is the same thing as h1 of lambda n, and it's the same thing as z. Okay. So now what we do, so we consider lambda n, and we consider, so take a loop of Lagrangian subspaces So I'll denote this loop by gamma. So it's a map from 0, 1 to lambda n. And to this loop, we would like to associate some number. So to gamma, we would like to associate some number. I'll write this number by mu of gamma, and this mu of gamma is defined to be an intersection number so this will be intersection number of gamma and the Maslow cycle that I denote by sigma, where sigma, so where sigma is defined the following way. So basically, if so is defined by, so if lambda is Lagrangian subspace, then we write lambda I, sigma I of lambda to be the subset of Lagrangian subspaces of lambda n, which intersect lambda, by a i-dimensional subspace. And sigma, in this case, is given by sigma 1 of lambda union dot 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 union sigma n of lambda. So this way we defined Maslow cycle, and this Maslow number is just intersection number of our loop that we take with the Maslow cycle. Okay.
So and then lambda is fixed.
Yeah, so here of course we are defining, yeah, so we are defining this Maslow cycle relative to some Lagrangian subspace. Yeah. To some fixed Lagrangian subspace. So in general, this type of thing, so this sigma is a, it's algebraic variety. Of codimension one and yeah. So this way we have this mu gamma, and now let's say we have a if we have a Legendrian, so given let's say a Legendrian submanifold. So now lambda will stay for Legendrian submanifold. Let's say which lives in R to the 2n plus 1 with a contact form dz minus sum of yi dxi. Or more generally, we can take P times R if you want to. Where we have a form dz plus theta.
So I'm sorry.
Yes.
So this is this sigma Maslow image is looks like the generic of the cohomology of n minus one. I mean, of the.
So you mean where in the Lagrangian Grassmannian?
No, I mean. So what is
yes.
the Maslow? So you have this loop.
Yeah, we have this loop in the Lagrangian, in the space of Lagrangian linear subspaces. Yes.
Yeah, loop in the Grassmannian.
Loop in the Grassmannian. Yeah.
Yeah. So the Maslow index.
Yes.
You're defining it, right?
Yeah.
It's basically the value in the pi one.
Yeah. So basically, it provides me the map, and since I have isomorphism, yeah. It gives me a map between h one of lambda n. Or if you want pi 1 of lambda n, which are the same, to z. So this is a, okay, so they are isomorphic. So this mu is just a map from either h1 or pi 1 to z.
Yeah. So that this description basically give a geometric interpretation of this
map. Yes, yeah. Yes.
What was the last one? Sigma k?
Sigma n. I mean, they can. It's n-dimensional, so they can intersect up to the subspaces of dimension n.
Okay.
You know, like the way we define it. So, and now if you have a Legendrian submanifold either in the Euclidean space or in the contactization of exact symplectic manifold, and you would like to define the grading, right, for the chord, and let's say we have a chord. We have chord C, okay. Then we have two points which corresponds to the this point C plus and C minus, so endpoints of this chord, endpoints of this chord C, such that the Z coordinate of C plus is higher than Z coordinate of C minus. Once again, it's three-dimensional situation. It corresponded to the case when the in the Lagrangian projection, C plus was something on the over cross. It will be this on the over strand, and C minus will be on the under strand, right? So in this case, of course, we don't have a strand. We have some like possibly higher dimensional picture, but we still have C plus and C minus. One has a higher Z coordinate and one has a lower Z coordinate. Right, so if you have something like this, what we can do, we can choose a path. So we choose a path. Let me denote it as I did yesterday by gamma C. So it's a map from 0, 1 to our lambda, such that gamma at 0. So you remember that we started from the overstrand yesterday. So that's the reason why we have gamma at 0 starts at C plus. We write absolutely the same thing. Gamma at 1 will be in C minus. So we started yesterday from the overstrand and got to the understrand. The same type of story here. And then if I take the Lagrangian projection, so composed with this path gamma C, okay, let's select this, then we take this type of composition, it defines a loop in Cn. So I'll write this loop by gamma t, which is by definition d of pi l T gamma C T lambda. So basically we just take a tangent of our map, right? And the tangent of our map will, so whenever we consider it on lambda, this will give us a loop of Lagrangian subspaces in Cn, right? And I mean, not loop in this case, it will be just path, because I mean, you remember even in three-dimensional case, we are supposed to close this loop, right? So a priori it will be just path, and then we will close it in some way, and then it will be a loop, right? So it defines a, let me write, I wrote loop, but to be honest, okay, maybe let me write path. So so for loop, it's still too early. So path in Cn, we write it as gamma t, and it's defined to be d pi l t gamma c t lambda. Okay, so t between 0 and 1. And then we would like to close this guy, right? So since our C corresponds to the double point of the projection, to the double point in the Lagrangian projection. Okay, we take a Legendrian submanifold, we project it, so this projection just forgets about Z coordinate, so it was embedded originally, so in the end we will have a double point where these two points, C plus and C minus, have different Z coordinates, but all other coordinates are the same, right? We have a transverse double point, okay? So since C corresponds to the transverse double point, in the Lagrangian projection, what we can do, So we can close this gamma to a loop. Okay? And how do we do it? So we do it the following way. So we write V0 to be gamma at 0 and dimensional subspace of Cn. And we write V1 to be gamma at 1. And we define some extra path between gamma V1 and V0 because we would like to close this loop, right? So in order to define this path, what we do, we choose complex structure L denoted by capital I on Cn such that this I of V1 is equal to V0. Once again, we have a transverse double point, right? That's the reason why we can choose this type of complex structure, right? If it wouldn't be transverse double point, then we will not be able to do this, right? But since it's a transverse double point, we can choose some complex structure satisfying this property, okay? And then we do the standard thing, this complex structure should be compatible with the symplectic forms that we have here. So also like such that like omega of V I V. So omega once again is sum of dxi dyi, right? So it's positive. So it's this compatibility condition with the symplectic structure. So we define the remaining this closing part. And define lambda V1 V0 of T to be E to the T V1 for T from 0 to pi 2. Okay. So this will be this closing part that allows us to take our gamma and then close the path to a loop from gamma 1 to gamma 0, right? Okay, so basically now what we do, we take a concatenation. So take a concatenation of our gamma and this lambda V1 V0 and get our loop. Okay. And I'll denote this loop by new gamma C. Okay. And we define the gradient of C to be the Maslow index of to be the Maslow index of this new gamma C minus 1. Okay, and this is sometimes called the Conley-Zender index.
So V0 and V1 necessarily intersect at like a point,
they,
right?
Yeah. So what we know, since it's a we have a transverse point, right? So which means that basically we have a transverse spaces, right? And we want to find a complex structure which rotates one space to another. Okay, So if they were not transverse, I mean, if you don't have like a double point, transverse right. double point, then a priori we do not have this type of thing, right? Yes. And we will not be able to close our path to a loop. But since it's a transverse double point, we are able to do this, and that's what we do basically. Right, so.
Some sense you have a canonical way to close it.
Well,
it's transverse.
Yes, yes, in a way, I mean, I don't know if it's like.
Does that depend on a choice of I? You have to choose a complex.
For a given path, I have a more or less canonical way to close the loop. But the choice of path is not canonical, of course, right?
No. So this I, the choice of I depends only on the position of in this V0 and V1. Right?
Yes. Yeah.
They are orthogonal.
Yes.
And then you choose the I, right?
Yes.
They're not orthogonal. They have
no, I mean.
No, they're not necessarily orthogonal, but they're transverse.
Transverse.
Yeah.
Then
yes.
Choose
then
okay,
I choose
once
it.
Once you have I, you have this canonical way to define.
Then I can define this type of like closing path canonically. Yeah. Yes. And basically, I take a loop and I compose it with this closing path. I mean, I have this path gamma, and I take this closing path and I close it in a like more or less canonical way to a loop, right? Yeah. So this type of thing, I mean, this type of construction basically depends on the. So the only real dependence is a dependence of the path I take in the beginning, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I have two paths, I have two choices.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So why U minus one in Maslow?
In order to make the formula for the Fredholm index nice. Let's say like this. So.
Like if you choose like a different complex structure, it's just like the number will be the same, right? Like that's the idea. I mean,
if I choose, sorry.
So here in our choice of the complex structure,
yes.
If we sort of choose a different complex structure,
So whenever I close, yes. Yeah. So it will be the same. Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Homotopically.
Yeah. It's homotopically the same. Yeah. Yes. 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 Yeah. So somehow here the only real dependence is the dependence of the path I take. So a bit long, but that's a way to define gradient. And once again, why one wants to do something like that? Because in the end of the day, when we will compute the dimension of the moduli space, we'll have when we'll compute the dimension of the moduli space with some inputs and outputs. This plus punctures and minus punctures, and the dimension will be something like a gradient of plus punctures minus gradient of minus punctures. Then there will be as a Maslow number for the element of pi 1 that corresponds to the whatever boundary of our disks that we count, and then there will be minus 1 corresponding to the whatever translation, so you'll consider everything in the contact manifold times R, so there will be a translation in R direction, there will be some minus one corresponding to this reparametrization by R. So basically this type of choice makes a formula nice, let's say like this, okay? So, yeah. At least for me, the explanation is like that.
Yeah, so yeah. It's like the recipe, if you have this family of Lagrangians.
Yeah.
Some of the endpoints do not match.
Yes.
But transverse, right? Then
yes.
You do this recipe and you turn it into a loop.
Yes.
And the Maslow index is defined.
I mean, not the tangents. So basically, what happens at the tangent level? They do not match, right?
Not
the points. The points. I mean, they consider everything in the Lagrangian projection. So the point is the same, but like at the level of tangences, we don't have the same thing.
Yeah.
But we would like to match the tangent spaces. We just want to close it up, right? Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is a gradient. Now let me get to the proper definition. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me be careful with this plus and minus one, sorry. Sorry about that. So there was a mistake, small mistake that I need to mention. So this guy is called the Condescender index, and the norm of C is the Condescender index minus one. Sorry, there was a mistake. So Maslow for this type of choice, the Maslow index for this composition is called Condescender, and the gradient is Condescender minus one. I mean, once again, sorry about that.
The Condescender is the one you close up.
Yeah, so the Condescender is a Maslow for the closed up, and then you might take minus one, and then you get a gradient. So gradient is a Condescender minus one. I mean,
In order to make the formula.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. So now let's get to the proper definition of the algebra. Okay, so once again, so we do the same type of things. We take lambda, we have this Q lambda, ripcords, the set of ripcords. So now lambda may live in, once again, so P times R is dz plus c. Okay. The set is still non-empty. And it's non-empty, and this set is still finite. So generically, we can always assume that we have a finite set. And once again, so we take our A lambda to be the unital, bless you, non-commutative differential graded algebra. Once again, let's assume over Z2, freely generated by the set Q lambda. So we have a tensor algebra. Now we explained how to get the gradient of C, right? So for every C in Q lambda, so this guy is given by this mu of gamma c minus one, right? If you want Condescender index minus one. Okay, so we know that. Now what's the differential? And now it gets more interesting, because there is a difference with what we've seen in dimension three with the combinatorial definition. Now we will see some real geometry. So what we do, we take this contact manifold and we form so-called symplectization. So take a symplectization of P times R. So this symplectization has a form R times P times R, so we just multiply it by one extra R. And on this extra R we have t coordinate, and we take a symplectic form given by d of e to the t. Let's say this form was alpha, so d of e to the t alpha. Okay. So this is a symplectization of a contact manifold. Now on this symplectization, we take almost complex structure. Capital G. So almost complex structure is just an endomorphism of the tangent bundle. So let me write for simplicity this guy as S of P times R. S stands for symplectization. So here we have a map from T of S P times R to itself with a property that J square is equal to minus identity. Okay. And also it satisfies the following properties. So this J maps contact structure to itself, right? So our contact form alpha defines the contact structure in P times R, right? And J maps psi to itself. And also it's compatible to alpha in the following way. So d alpha of V JV is greater than zero for V in the contact structure. So this J is T invariant. Namely, at each T slice, it takes the same. And the final property is that J maps D over DT to D over DZ, right? Yes. So this way, so we have this type of endomorphism of the tangent bundle of the symplectization. Okay. Now we consider the following things that we already considered combinatorially, but now not in the projection of the contact manifold, but somehow in some creature, in some manifold of one dimension higher. Okay, so we still consider disks. So you remember that we, like in the combinatorial case, we consider this n plus one gons, right? But n plus one gon is the same thing as a closed disk where we remove some points from the boundary. You can actually associate it. You can associate this to geometric objects. So now we take, take the following maps. I'll write them as U, which will be written as AF, and it's a map from D2 minus some points, X, Y1, YK, where these points are removed from the boundary. If you want, this is a, you can think about it as a unit disk, so closed unit disk, unit disk in C. And here we have like a standard complex structure I, okay? And we map them to this symplectization in such a way that the boundary is mapped to R times our Legendrian submanifold. Namely, boundary is mapped to the cylinder over our Legendrian submanifold. And so there are some properties, of course. So, and such that I'll draw some picture. It will be easier to see, so that it will be easier to see what's going on. So such that, so first of all, it should be pseudo-holomorphic. Namely, du composed with I is capital J composed with du, okay? This is this condition that says that U is holomorphic. And now, so this A corresponds to the to what happens at this R coordinate, and F corresponds to what happened on this P times R part, right? So limit of A P when P goes to X will be plus infinity. Limit of AP when P goes to YI will be minus infinity. Limit, then let's say if you have a point X, okay, on our disk. So, okay, so let me draw it like this. So we have our disk and we have point X. So near this point X, we can consider some polar coordinates, right? So we can consider some polar coordinates rho and theta. And in these coordinates, we can write that limit of f rho ei theta, namely some points near x, right? As rho goes to zero, will be given by, I'll write then explain. So c plus of minus t plus theta over pi. And also, let's say if this is yi, then limit as rho goes to zero of f rho ei theta is equal to ci minus ti minus theta pi, where c plus and c1 minus ck minus are rib chords. And we can think about c plus as a map from 0 t plus to lambda, and similar for c minus. So basically it's just a length. So this t plus, it's a length of our chord c plus. And chord ci minus has length ti minus. Okay. Okay, so maybe let me draw the picture. Sorry, maybe this will help. So the picture.
The circles, the half circles.
Half circles.
Converges to the rib chords.
Yes. So basically, if you want.
These circles.
So this type of guys. So whenever we approach this removed point, they will approach the rib chord. Okay. And this rib chord, which corresponds to x, will be at positive infinity. And this rib chord ci, c1 minus ck minus, that correspond to yi's, they will be at negative infinity. And there are possibly many of them. Or possibly none. Right? Because you remember that we... Yeah, what's that?
To the positive.
To the positive, there is always one. To the negative, we either have something or don't. Okay, so... Okay, so what's the geometric picture? If I don't draw it, I'll completely confuse you, and you know, you will leave the room. So we have this U. It's a map from the disk, where here we remove some point X, we remove some point Y1, I don't know, Y2, YK. Just a unit disk living in C, and we have our standard complex structure given by the multiplication with the imaginary unit. And we consider a map to R, okay, times our Legendrian submanifold lambda. I'll draw it, so this is our cylinder over lambda, right? So as I said here, we would like to map our disks in such a way that the boundary of the disks lives on the boundary of this cylinder. Okay, so lives on this, not on the boundary, but lives on this cylinder. So all this picture lives in this R times P times R, right? So this is this T, this extra R direction, okay? And now what's going on? So here I have this C plus, okay? So this is my copy of my lambda at positive infinity, right? So think about it as a positive infinity. And this is what happens at negative infinity. And here inside I have something like zero, right? So this is like very somewhere at negative infinity. This is something at positive infinity. Okay, and here I have chords C1 minus, C2 minus, dot, 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 CK minus, okay? And my disk, so the boundary of my disk, lives on this cylinder, right? So the boundary of my disk is this. We go here we have this point, right? Then I go like this, then we have this chord, then I have something like this, then I have a chord, and then I have the last part of the boundary, right? So basically, this is the boundary of my disk, and that's how it lives on this cylinder. And disk is somewhere here. I don't know what the disk is, but this is a picture, right? Okay, and how to see the correspondence with what we did in dimension 3? Basically, this type of disk can be projected all the way to P, right? Here we consider P times R times one extra R, okay? But you can project it all the way to P. And the point is that if you have nice, almost complex structures like this, okay, then actually there is a one-to-one correspondence between this disks are embedded, like embedded disks like this, and immersed disks that exist on P. Okay? And actually in dimension two, I mean, you can do everything in such a way that you just count this immersed polygons, you know, you don't even say things like pseudo-holomorphic or anything like that, you just count some immersed polygons and that's it.
Then you say complex structure, you mean the
interior of the series that match? Yes, so in order to have this correspondence, you need to have some class of, so for some nice complex structures, you can have this type of class.
Nice means this and plus.
This plus a bit of extra. Yeah, I mean, in order to have this correspondence, so Yorgos actually has this paper about lifting pseudo-holomorphic disks, where he shows correspondence in the case of P times R. You need a bit of extra.
Which paper?
Yorgos Dimitroglou-Rizal from 2000.
Yorgos?
14. Rizal, I think on archive it appears on 14, maybe in 2016. It was published in Quantum Topology. I can give you a link if you want. So, in
the definition, you require the disk to be embedded, or you...
Here we just consider pseudo-holomorphic, you just have just maps, like honest embeddings of disks to the symplectization of a contact manifold.
Yeah, so not just arbitrary map, not just
Here we just consider maps. We don't consider embeddings. Yes. You just consider maps. Okay, so I just consider maps.
Do you have regularity result in some cases? And
let me define at least modulus. So let me write what I need to write. So we consider these disks, we consider these maps, right? And then we consider moduli space. I'll write it as MJ. And there will be some A. And there will be C plus, C1 minus, CK minus. So this will be a moduli space of such disks. With the property that after we take these capping passes, right, the concatenation of the boundary of the disk plus capping passes will give us this class A, right? So you remember that to C, right, we associate like mu of, I already removed it, of this gamma concatenation with lambda, right? So basically, we associate to C some class A. So which gives us this mu of A, right? Because basically the gradient is computing using the Maslow of some element of H1, right? So our moduli space will be decorated by this A, okay? And we define D of C plus to be the sum with respect to C1 minus CK minus. So that the dimension of this moduli space after we quotient it by R is equal to zero. And here we count mod 2, the number of elements in this moduli space. So once again, to C, you associate some element in H1, actually in pi 1, but it can be seen also in H1. You remember when we define the gradient, you need to have a loop, right?
Loop is A.
Okay.
Yes.
I see.
Yeah. And this is exactly the guy that we take in order to decorate the moduli space. So it's some class, some element of H1, which allows us to compute the gradient.
Like it should depend on the element of H1 because it's just C generator, right? I mean, just Z generator. Why?
Yeah.
So why can't you just choose a generator of H1 and then? stop there.
Okay, I can say that
it's a monotopic class, right? It's constant H1.
It's element, yeah, it's an element H1. Yes, yes. So it's an H1 H1 of
which is Z.
Yes.
So then only one generator.
Sorry, it's a, not an H1, it's an H1 of lambda. So what I'm trying to say is that, so there is a theorem that generically the dimension of this moduli space, so already, what I already said, so why I want to use it, that the generically, this dimension is given as a gradient of C plus minus the gradient of the C1 minus CK minus plus mu of A minus 1. Okay?
So
the dimension of this creature can be expressed in such a nice.
The transversality.
J is defined on the contact structure, and then it's extended by doing this. Yeah. But this type of extension, I mean, since it's like T invariant, and you know, it's compatible, and you know, defined this way, yeah, it's more or less, yeah.
Yeah. So the being generic means in that sense.
Yes.
You keep these conditions.
Yes. Yeah.
Can you say something about the difference between this gradient, the absolute value C's and mu? It seems like they are very similar objects. The gradient of the count.
It just shifted by one.
It just shifted by one.
And but then this formula, why you write this difference? Absolute value C plus, C minus.
I mean, it's not absolute value. It's not an absolute value. It's a gradient of C plus.
But
yeah.
That gradient should be like mu of A.
Well.
How much mu of A differs from C plus? C plus, you also, you go around, you see the, how many times
it
intersects
that
algebraic variety.
I see what you're saying. Okay. Okay, maybe I didn't explain it in the correct way. Maybe I didn't explain it in the correct way. I think I understand your question. So you have C plus, C1 minus, CK minus. Here you have this plus gamma C plus, gamma C1 minus, gamma CK minus. Okay? Yeah. So you have a pass, keeping pass for each such chord.
You have a
pass. Pass.
Yeah.
And then you compose, so this guy, this mu A, this A doesn't correspond just to C plus. It corresponds to this boundary of the disk composed with the capping passes.
Yes.
So this is a, like, you go here, pass, go here, pass, go here, pass, go here, and pass.
And that is mu.
And this A is a class in H1.
So this is the description of mu of A?
This gives us a loop. Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
What is it, in which term is it in this dimensional formula? C plus, C minus in this formula.
So we have this formula. This formula involves this gradient of C plus. And for C plus, we have this class. I can write it, I don't know. AC plus. And here, for each of these guys, we have AC1 minus ACK minus, which gives us Maslow's and which gives us Condizenders. But this A, it has nothing to do with those guys. This A is a composition of the boundary and capping passes here. Okay?
So
it uses capping passes, but it's a composition. It's basically you. Okay. So this guy, it lives here.
So U actually comes from the U, A comes from the U, the map U, the boundary.
A comes from the U.
Or you specify U using A.
You have U,
yeah.
Right? You have U, you know how the boundary
behaves. Yeah.
And then for each this limiting thing, you have also capping pass.
Yeah.
that you've chosen, right, in order to compute the gradient. And then you take a composition, I mean, not a composition, but concatenation somehow. Part of the boundary, Kapin pass. Part of the boundary, Kapin pass. Part of the boundary, Kapin pass. And you get a class, and this class is used to decorate.
Yeah.
Okay.
That one is a A.
Yes.
You use that to specify.
Yes. You use that to decorate. Okay, some people, when they write the formulas, they even don't write this A, but since I would like to write the precise formula for the dimension, I want to say what it is. Some people just remove this A and just say something like this. So if the dimension is equal to zero, you know, you do the count. Now you can say, well, I mean, why actually you can't do this count? I mean, even if the dimension is equal to zero, right? So there is a Gromov compactness theorem, which tells you that in this particular situation, that whatever you will have will be a compact zero-dimensional manifold. And compact zero-dimensional manifold is a finite number of points, and so that you can count. Okay.
After you mod R.
After you mod by R, and this mod by R means that basically you, if you have a holomorphic disk, and you can shift and you shift it in T direction, it will still remain holomorphic. Because our almost complex structure is actually T-invariant, right?
Yeah.
So if you have a holomorphic disk, you shift it, it will be like that, so you would like to, to...
So then you don't have this like somehow trivial case where you have something like which is fixed by the R translation.
No, I mean, here, of course, we are like all the family is reduced to just, I mean, so what I'm saying is that if you have disk, you have a one parametric family of such disks. Yeah. And you would like to count it only as a disk, not as a one parametric family. That's the reason why you take a quotient by R. And that's somehow the reason why you have this minus one there.
Okay.
Because once again, if you have one holomorphic curve, you have one parametric family given by the translation in T direction.
Yeah.
Okay, so it was a bit long, but this is a general definition. Okay. Now, this type of algebra, whatever we do, if you define it in dimension 3, or if you define it in general, it's still a complicated creature. And even if you have generically we have only finite number of rib chords, but since this algebra is non-commutative, whenever it's non-zero in some degree, it's almost always infinite dimensional there. So it's difficult to get something interesting, some interesting information from it. So the way to get some information is through so-called linearizations or augmentations. So how much time do I have?
4 minutes.
Okay. Can I have 10? Yeah, sorry for being slightly silly. But, okay. So, the way to get some interesting information from this algebra is using so-called augmentations. So these augmentations, they are basically, so augmentation is a differential gradient algebra, graded algebra map. So we have our algebra A lambda. Is our differential D, okay? And this algebra was defined over Z2, the way we did it. So it's a map to ground ring or field, in this case it's Z2, with a zero differential. So what does it mean to be a differential algebra, graded algebra map? So also I need to write unital, right? So our algebra is unital, so it should be a map of unital algebra. So what it should do, it should map one to one, right? And it should be a chain map, namely epsilon composed with D should be zero. And usually people ask for one extra condition. Sometimes people say that it's extra, sometimes not. So I'll write this as a graded condition, which means that epsilon of C must be equal to zero for C chord with the property that gradient of C is different from zero. Namely, we map to zero whatever that has a gradient different from zero. Okay? So this is so-called documentation. It turns out, even though it looks simple, it turns out that this type of thing sometimes exists and sometimes doesn't exist. Okay? But if it exists, so if epsilon exists, then we can do the following trick. So we write, so for Chekhanov-Eliasberg algebra, we wrote curly A. Now I'll write just standard A. So this will be a Z2 vector space generated by ripchords. We have finite number of ripchords. We have finite dimensional Z2 vector space. And we modify our differential. We write d epsilon on C to be of the following form. So here, once again, we write C1 minus dot 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 Ck minus, such that the dimension of this moduli space, C plus C1 minus Ck minus, let me not write this decoration, quotient by R. And here we write one extra sum with I. Now here we have the same thing, so the number of elements in the, so zero, the number of elements in this moduli space. Okay, we take, we count them, mod 2. And now what we do, we actually split our word, C1 minus Ck minus, into two parts. Okay? So on everything up to the letter I minus, we act by epsilon, right? On each chord, so when we act by epsilon on a chord, we get a number, okay? And here we have a product of these numbers. Here we have the Ci minus, and once again, we have a product of these numbers, okay? This way, we get a linear map from A lambda to A lambda.
How did this help? I mean, by putting this thing.
What?
How does this make it linear map?
I mean, it is a linear map.
How did this improve that without augmentation case?
So here,
what did this augmentation do for us?
So here, as I said, you have a non-commutative algebra. Yeah. Basically, you have words of arbitrary length, right?
This is when epsilon makes it an element.
Epsilon makes it. So this is number. This is number. Number, and this is number. So basically, you have number times some letter times some number. So you map letter to the number times letter. Okay. So you have a map from vector space to the vector space, not from the algebra to algebra, okay? So, so this way, you can define so-called linearized Legendrian contact homology. I'll write it as L C H epsilon lambda. So this linearization depends on epsilon. And this will be a homology of this A lambda D epsilon. Okay. Now, unfortunately, if I fix epsilon, whatever I write, it's not a Legendrian invariant. It's not invariant up to Legendrian isotopy. But there is a theorem of at home at Nyer and Sullivan. It says that if I take the set of all possible LCH with respect to all possible epsilons, you see, we have finite number of chords. Let's say we are talking about Z2 coefficients. For each of these chords, we have only two possible values, 0, 1. So we have finite number of augmentations. So this finite set of homologies is a Legendrian invariant. Well, but it's a nice cheating. It's like the part that you can actually play with. You know, like if you have this huge algebra, you have no idea what to do. I mean, it's difficult to compute even the quotient, you know. And what's funny, sometimes like there are some Legendrians with the properties that when you take a quotient, it becomes algebraically uncontrolled. So for example, you cannot define like free modules over it or something like that. So it's like, it's just crazy. But here you can get some nice vector spaces, linear maps of vector spaces, something that you can compute. Okay, so my time is almost gone. Let me just say that these augmentations, they come from, sometimes they are geometric, okay? And actually these days, there is this claim, propaganda claim, that they are all supposed to be geometric and they come from sheaves. I will not talk too much about that, but honestly, we can see that sometimes they come from the exact Lagrangian cobordisms, exact Lagrangian fillings of Legendrian knots. Yeah. If you have a filling, you can define this type of augmentation. Okay. I will talk about it. And if you have really filling, and if you have augmentation, it turns out that this type of thing has a topological meaning. It can be, it's basically the same thing as a singular homology of this filling. And this is given by the Seidel isomorphism. I'll talk about that. Also, as I said, so sometimes they do not exist, and there are some Legendrian submanifolds for which they do not exist. These are so-called loose Legendrian submanifolds. So let's say in dimension 3, stabilized knots. So whenever your algebra is a cyclic, whenever the homology vanishes, you know, you cannot do this type of thing, right? So for this type of guys, for these loose guys, for example, you cannot defend. And also I'll talk about it next time. So thanks a lot for your attention.